It's time for Security Now. Steve Gibson is here. Lots to talk about. He's finally going to break his silence about John McAfee. And then we'll look at an academic security flaw called CacheBleed. It's probably not something you need to worry about too much, but it is fascinating. Also, quantum computing. How soon? It's all next on Security Now.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Security Now is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. Hi, everybody. It's time for our annual audience survey. We'd really like to hear from you. It helps us understand our audience better, know what you like and don't like, how you listen to the show. It also helps us tell advertisers what kind of people listen. But I promise you, your feedback is always kept personally anonymous. All you have to do is visit twit.tv/survey and let us know what you think. It'll just take a few minutes, and it'll help us make TWiT even better. We really appreciate your support and any help you can give us. twit.tv/survey. This is Security Now with Steve Gibson, episode 550, recorded Tuesday, March 8th, 2016. CacheBleed. Security Now is brought to you by Squarespace. Squarespace is the simplest way to create a beautiful website. Plus, with a developer platform, you can customize the code behind any Squarespace design. Enter the offer code Security Now and get 10% off Squarespace. You should. And by the Ring Video Doorbell. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door from anywhere in the world. Using your smartphone, it's like caller ID for your house. Right now, get free expedited FedEx shipping when you go to ring.com/securitynow. It's time for Security Now, the show where we talk about all the latest security news. We help protect you. We help you understand what's going on. And really, that's almost the most important role that this guy plays, the explainer-in-chief, Steve Gibson. Hi, Steve.
Hey, Leo. Great to be with you again. For episode 550.
Wow.
I like those round numbers. Now, 555, that'll be another good one. Mm-hmm. And then there'll be 567, and okay, I'm done. Then probably nothing really of interest until 1,000.
I think we missed a bet. We should have numbered the show. Well, you always wanted to start at 0. But I think we should have done it in hexadecimal.
Ooh, that would have been
Wouldn't
good.
Have been funny?
Although that would have scrambled up some people.
Nobody
like, wait
would.
A minute.
What?
AB2? What?
Chat room, what is 550 in hex? Well, somebody's got a hex calculator there sitting around. It'd be kind of fun.
Yeah, so it'll be a one eight.
He's doing hex in his head, folks.
Yeah, I can, but of course I've got what hex calculator within reaching distance. I didn't want to cheat though. Decimal 550 is hex. 226.
226. Chicken head got it. 226. Yeah, that would confuse the hell out of people.
Yeah. Especially when it goes to 22B.
Yeah.
And they're like, wait, what? Where's A? Well, A was in front of B. But then, you know, C and D and F.
We
and,
can't
you know,
really do
two,
that.
2-2-E.
Yeah, yeah. It wouldn't work.
I don't think.
So I see that the show's title is CacheBleed. I guess that's an appropriate topic for today.
Well, I had intended to, as I said last week, to do Drown and CacheBleed. But the week provided so much entertainment, not including McAfee, who admitted that he was lying before. I didn't even cover him. Deliberately didn't talk about him the last couple
weeks. He said he could. First, he was going to have his crack team of hackers social engineer their way into the San Bernardino iPhone. That was blatantly bizarre since the owner was dead. There's not much you could do there. And then he said, oh, everybody knows how to crack an iPhone.
Just give it to me and, you know. And
I'll eat my shoe. He said, and I'm hoping he's going to do it, I'll eat my shoe if I can't crack that iPhone.
Yeah, I don't know if you notice he's walking around in chocolate shoes now. So that's not a big deal. But anyway, so there has been finally that has sort of come full circle. So that and a whole bunch of other stuff. Of course, RSA is going on, so there's some RSA stuff. So anyway, the Drown attack is so cool that I didn't want to shortchange it. The CacheBleed attack is also cool. It's a new form of side channel attack that is effective against even the latest OpenSSL the OpenSSL, which is deliberately engineered to thwart side channel attacks, so that the, as we've talked about before, the way you do that is you don't allow your keying material to change the order of execution of the instructions, because that can be sensed by power drop or power consumption or radio emissions or whatever. So even on code where the keying material doesn't change the code execution, some very clever researchers have figured out still how to suck keying out of OpenSSL. So that's the big topic for this week after we catch up with a whole week of really great news. So a great podcast. And I completely, it's really annoying now that second Microsoft Second Tuesday collides with our Tuesday. And I'm wondering, maybe I could call somebody and say, hey, look, move that release of your patches. Yeah. On the
Terrible
other hand,
timing.
They laughed at me when I told them to take raw sockets out of XP, so I doubt that there's much chance that we're going to get them to change when they release their patches. But this is Patch Tuesday being the 8th of the month, last Tuesday being the 1st. And I haven't even looked at it, except that when I turned my Win 7 box on, it said, and I had just finished updating it a couple days ago, it said, oh, 13 important or 13 important updates. So I just said, fine, go do it, and I'll check and see if there's any emergencies, but I don't think so. I certainly haven't seen any in the news, so it's not like there was everyone going, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, and you know, through all the other inputs that I have, and this is the Tuesday that fixes that. So there's nothing that we know of that is pending and is a catastrophe for Windows at the moment. So great podcast, and here we go.
Well, let me interrupt as usual before we get too far down the road and get our first commercial in here, because those fine folks at Squarespace pay for the bandwidth and the data and some of Steve's time, not all of it probably, but we want to give them a little plug. And of course, that's where I put my website. And one of the reasons I really like Squarespace is because I don't have to worry about security on a Squarespace site. I was running a WordPress site for a long time and really felt like I did more updating of WordPress than I did actually blogging. Actually, I didn't even feel like it. I know that's the case with Squarespace because they're doing the hosting and the software. They keep it up to date. They keep it secure for you. And I don't know of any exploit ever on a Squarespace site. It's just really well done. You start with beautiful templates. Now, of course, they use the best designers to make these templates, but people listening to this show might also want to know they use the best engineering on these templates. They are all mobile responsive. They all have e-commerce built in, and Squarespace has a fantastic developer platform that you don't need to use this, and a lot of people with no coding skill, no really nothing, no HTML knowledge or anything, do Squarespace sites. I didn't have to use any JavaScript or CSS to do my Leoville website, and it looks great because I used a great template. It works beautifully. It's mobile responsive and all of that. But if you want to get geeky, just flip the switch. Register as a developer, flip the developer toggle. Suddenly you've got total control over your site's HTML, its CSS, its JavaScript. You have a JSON API to output content from the CMS, so it's easy for you to modify things. Or you could even build your own, you know, front end. Start with one of the existing templates. You could see the code, which is kind of fun. Use the base template. Start from the ground up. You can even use SFTP and Git. I just love Squarespace. Mobile's built in. Free custom domain name with annual purchase. Whether you're a developer or not, you're going to want to build your next site on Squarespace. And, of course, the 24/7 support is awesome. Peace of mind once I moved to Squarespace. I used the cover page. That was the first thing I did. And it's fun to see the different sites people create. Here's Nick and Sabrina's wedding that they created with one of the Squarespace templates. Yeah, it'd be great for that, too, a special event. And then you could send your guests to the website, and all the information would be there. And I mean, it just really is kind of neat. Hey, look, go to squarespace.com. Try it out today. If you decide to buy, do me a favor. Use the offer code security now, and you'll get 10% off and show your support for the show. Squarespace.com. It's the best place to make your next website. Squarespace, you should. You should. And, you know, I don't want to issue a challenge or anything, but I don't think you can DDoS a Squarespace site. Squarespace probably would prefer I don't say that, but I don't think you can. We've never seen a Squarespace site go down. All right, back to Steve Gibson and security now.
So I don't know why I am not yet in the habit of putting the topic that corresponds with the picture of the week as the first topic of the week, because I want to like note the picture of the week, and then I'm saying, okay, we're going to talk about this later. Well, let's talk about it now.
All right.
Because the picture of the week is wonderful, and the news just occurred. The EFF put out a press release that the Let's Encrypt initiative has issued its millionth free HTTPS cert. And it began, that picture of the week shows that it was a little ways into December of 2015 that this went online. It was out of beta and they began issuing certs in earnest. And so we have December, January, February, and we are the same little bit a bit into March, and they have crossed the 1 million mark. What's also interesting is that some of the certs are multi-domain. So they are actually covering 2.5 million fully qualified domain names. They said 3 months from the first beta version of the service becoming available, Let's Encrypt has passed this significant landmark and is helping to ensure websites are more secure with encryption. Moreover, since a single certificate can cover more than one domain, the million certs Let's Encrypt CA has issued are actually valid for 2.5 million domain names. They also said, and I thought this was interesting, much more work remains to be done before the internet is free from insecure protocols. But this is substantial and rapid progress. It is clear that the cost and bureaucracy of obtaining certificates was forcing many websites to continue with the insecure HTTP protocol long after we've known that HTTPS needs to be the default. We're very proud to be seeing that change and helping to create a future in which newly provisioned websites are automatically secure and encrypted. Now, I guess I'll buffer that a little bit and to suggest that when encryption is made this easy, then yes, there's absolutely no reason not to use it. But certainly, even among this initial million certificates and 2.5 million domains, there's sort of opportunistic encryption. There's like, well, yeah, why? I mean, it's a blog and nobody needs security there. But hey, it's better to have it be encrypted. We know that Google is if they haven't yet, they've been talking about biasing search results pro encrypted sites. So that's another reason to encrypt, is for higher Google search rankings. And I'll remind people again that this is still it's a very minimal level of true security. For example, I'm continuing with to buy certificates from DigiCert, my absolute favorite certificate provider. And I just did that 2 weeks ago. I refreshed all of GRC's certificates. I'd had older ones that I had co-issued, both in SHA-1 and SHA-256. I switched over on New Year's Eve so that Google's Chrome browser wouldn't be upset, and yet I was still able to use SHA-1 through 2015 without raising any alarm so that people could get to GRC who had older browsers. For example, had the corporate appliances that were signing the certs with their SHA-1 private key. But again, the reason I'm buying DigiCert certificates is that I want to have the extended validation where they go much further than just saying, yes, you have demonstrated control over this domain name. It's, yes, you have proven you are Gibson Research Corporation, a corporation in good standing. You're known through other real world means and so forth. Which is not, again, everybody knows what a fan I have been of Let's Encrypt. What this does, though, is it expands the ecosystem essentially to automate the process of getting a certificate for a domain name, which represents nothing more than that. Yet that does provide encryption, potentially for everything. There's no reason not to use it to encrypt your website. It's free and it's easy. And the graph is just wonderful. I mean, it is an exponential looking graph. It's got some kinks in it. It's not a smooth exponential curve. So there were some events at various points. Who knows what? Like maybe a major hosting provider incorporated automated Let's Encrypt certificates so that suddenly all of their hosted domains were able to be HTTPS. That's the kind of thing that helps this to happen. And I'm sure that what we'll see in the future is, if it isn't already, and I haven't looked, is that later distributions of the Nginx and Apache and maybe someday even IIS will just incorporate the Let's Encrypt protocol in their base. So you don't even have to go get it. It's on by default, and you have to say, no, I'm going to install, I would rather use my own higher level of assertion certificate. But then if you don't override it, it just gets one from Let's Encrypt. Why wouldn't it? So anyway, really, really, really great progress. I wanted to just mention a tiny mention of the smartphone encryption update. And that is, we talked last week about how Judge Orenstein, I think it was, had agreed with Apple and stated that the FBI was the Department of Justice was overreaching with their request that Apple unlock an iPhone 5C that had iOS 7, which means Apple could unlock that phone if they chose to. They were resisting, as they will. And the judge argued that the All Writs Act was insufficient. It was like just way the wrong approach. And so the news since then is that the Justice Department is appealing that decision. And so the battle goes on. And hopefully, as we all know, this ends up in front of Congress's committees. And in fact, while we were doing the podcast last week, one was underway. And this is looking very good for the people that are encouraging encryption. I mean, I'm really hopeful now that this may turn out okay, because we've got The NSA agreeing that strong encryption is important. So, I mean, you know, the NSA. All other commercial entities, all of the academic crypto, all the cryptographers, I mean, everybody. So it's essentially, it's everyone saying what law enforcement wants is wrong. And it'll be difficult to see how Congress can, just ignore all of that, this overwhelming support for what Apple is waging. I didn't hear you talk about it on Mac Break Weekly, but I imagine you had to. The first Mac ransomware to appear. What happened is that on March 4th, Palo Alto Networks was quick to detect that the installer for a nice, fast, easy, free BitTorrent client was bringing along a little more than the fast, easy, and free BitTorrent client. It had a fully mature and operational ransomware, technically the first for the Mac. They have a very nice short brief on this that I'll just share because it's hard to say it any cleaner than they said. They said, on March 4th, we detected that the transmission BitTorrent client installer for OS X was infected with ransomware just a few hours after installers were initially posted. We have named the ransomware Key Ranger, K-E capital R-A-N-G-E-R. The only previous ransomware for OS X we're aware of is FileCoder. And I remember us talking about it 2 years ago, which was discovered by Kaspersky Lab in 2014. As FileCoder was incomplete at the time of its discovery, we believe KeyRanger is the first fully functional ransomware seen on the OS X platform. Attackers infected two installers of transmission version 2.90 with KeyRanger on the morning of March 4th. When we identified the issue, the infected DMG files were still available for downloading from the Transmission site. Transmission is an open source project. It's possible that Transmission's official website was compromised, and that certainly seems likely, and the files were replaced by recompiled malicious versions, but we cannot confirm how this infection occurred. The KeyRanger application was signed with a valid Mac app development certificate. Therefore, it was able to bypass Apple's gatekeeper protection. If a user installs the infected apps, an embedded executable file is run on the system. KeyRanger then waits for 3 days before connecting with command and control servers over the Tor anonymizer network. The malware then begins encrypting certain types of document and data files on the system. After completing the encryption process, KeyRanger demands that victims pay one Bitcoin, about $400 at this time, to a specific address to receive their files. Additionally, KeyRanger appears to still be under active development, and it seems the malware is also attempting to encrypt Time Machine backup files to prevent victims from recovering their backup data. Palo Alto Networks reported the ransomware issue to the Transmission Project and to Apple on March 4th. Apple has since revoked the abused certificate and updated X-Protect antivirus signature. And Transmission Project has removed the malicious installers from its website. Palo Alto Networks has also updated URL filtering and threat prevention. Those are its products to stop KeyRanger from impacting systems. And so a couple of interesting details. KeyRanger infected that transmission installers that, as I mentioned, were signed with a legitimate certificate. It was a developer whose certificate was owned by a Turkish company, and a different developer ID was used to sign previous versions of the transmission installer. So that indeed suggests that the way this happened was that either the Turkish company's certificate got loose, or an employee there, or who knows what. But it was signed.
No, they think the bad guys actually were the Turkish company.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
you can't get arrested, I guess. I don't know.
And so probably then the site was, you know, broken into somehow, defaced, and those files were replaced.
Same thing, you know, it just happened recently with another open source project where, Mint Linux, same exact thing. Remember that?
Yes.
It just because it's open source, it makes it a little easier because you can recompile the whole thing and just put in the installer, put a little extra, little something, something.
Yep. And in fact, I remember that we talked about that. And that's why it's one of the reasons I don't provide open source. Not only is it all assembly language with, you know, a whole ton of custom include files, and people would just, you know, say, what is he doing over here? But also, I don't want my stuff, the GRC apps, to be cloned and offered in other file downloading sites. So anyway, after connecting to the command and control server, and retrieving the encryption key from the user's computer, thus exporting it so that it is that the CNC server has it, then the executable will traverse the /users and /volumes directories, encrypting all files under /users and encrypt all files under /volumes, which have specific extensions. And the Palo Alto Networks document specifies, it enumerates some of them, and basically it's 300 different file extensions, which to me looks like everything it can possibly encrypt, but your system still runs. So, you know, it's not encrypting the kernel itself, but, you know, all your documents, all your images, audio files, archives, source code, database files, email, and certificates. So, you know, everything that you've added to the system that you value and care about is scrambled. So if anyone worries that they may have be, I mean, if they're hearing about this for the first time, it's people who would have downloaded the transmission BitTorrent client from 11 a.m. Pacific time on March 4th through 7 p.m. on March 5th. That's when it finally got taken down. They could have been, you know, those people could be running right now this ransomware.
Yeah, you'd know pretty quickly.
I was looking at the date. Today's the 8th, so unfortunately,
it started yesterday. It didn't start doing anything until Monday.
Correct.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, so if you downloaded it late in the day on the 5th, and you hear this now, unplug your computer. take it off the net. Because you do not want to let it get in touch with the command and control server. It will not do anything until it's established that relationship. So keeping it from connecting is your emergency pull the cord out of the wall maneuver. And then there are remediation steps. I've got the link to the announcement. I'm sure there are other things since. I didn't go digging deep for other references, but there must be other things telling you what to do if you think you've got this. But the Palo Alto Networks link that I have in the show notes does have a steps you can take to get this thing out of your system before it activates.
And they've shipped an update that actually removes the malware.
Apple has?
No, Transmission has.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
So, in fact, Apple immediately pulled their cert, which means Gatekeeper would, if you tried to run the installer at this point, would say, no, you can't install that.
Right.
And they added the they have a kind of hidden malware detection and removal tool that gets updated. They've added the signature for it to that.
Nice.
So I think you're it's 6,500 people downloaded it, according to Transmission. We haven't heard of anybody who actually got their files encrypted.
Nice.
And, of course, the best thing is if you have a good backup, you're also okay. You just delete the encrypted files and start over.
Right. Yeah. Well, and so this demonstrates the need for fast response. And it is very cool that it was signed by a cert that could be instantly revoked and that revocation pushed out. So that you know, immediately the ecosystem responded and
that's a good system. Blocked. That's the gatekeeper system. It really works.
Yes.
Yeah. It's really good.
Yeah. And of course, this is why I spent some time last year being upset with Google over Chrome's absolutely non-functional revocation system. Yeah. They say that it works, but we prove that it doesn't. You go to revoked.grc.com with Chrome and it says, oh yeah. That's fine, except that that's a revoked certificate. So,
but it complains if you go to somebody sent me a note saying you're using an old SSL. You're using whatever it was #128 on our Tech Guy Labs site, which doesn't have SSL. But if you, I guess, if you enter https://. TechGuyLabs.com, you'll get an error message. But that's because there is no cert on there. So I don't know what.
I know.
Thank you, Google.
I know. So the RSA conference happened and a bit of news came out.
I'm thinking next year we should cover this and you should be there.
I should. I probably should.
Yeah, and we'll cover it with you.
You know, the one time that I went was Stina.
You met Stina, I know.
I mean, look what happened with Yubico as a consequence of that. So, yeah, I it's just a matter of time. But yeah, it would be fascinating. And in fact, why do I think I have a link? Oh, I do. It's later in the show notes. I have a link to the official posted by RSA Cryptographers Forum, which is fascinating. It is literally, in the case of Whitfield Diffie, the white bearded cryptographer. It's the whole RSA team and a few other guys who are very active. You know, the fathers of crypto for 47 minutes having a really great conversation about cryptography. Anyway, we'll get there in a second. And I also created a Bitly link. I think it's just RSA crypto, all lowercase, RSA CRIPTO, and that will bounce you over to the. YouTube video that's really, really worthwhile. Anyway, everybody's wondering and worrying that quantum computing spells the end of cryptography. And so I just sort of want to assuage people's concerns. What was just released in the IEEE Spectrum magazine and site was some news from a breakthrough at MIT and the University of Innsbruck, who made a breakthrough in quantum crypto factoring of a number. Now, the number was 15. And that's the biggest.
They factored 15?
They did.
Wow. They let's see. 5, 3, and 1. Wow.
An unbelievable amount of technology. They had cryo compressors cranking away. They brought the temperature down. They've stabilized the platform so that it wouldn't shake the atoms out of alignment. And they managed to factor the number 15.
It's pretty impressive.
Now, it did it very fast.
Yeah.
Well, it did it atomically, you know.
Yeah.
What they wrote, so I have in my show notes, I wrote there was a recent breakthrough MIT and the University of Innsbruck researchers made who successfully used a device known as an ion trap containing 5 atoms to successfully compute the factors of the number 15. Now, okay, what is cool is that five atoms can somehow do that. And I have no idea how. I haven't gotten around to looking into it. I do, however, I thought, you know, as I was writing this down, I thought, you know, I think I had a book I was getting ready to read. And so I'm holding up in front of the screen a book titled Post-Quantum Cryptography.
Wow.
And the lead author right up at the top is our friend Daniel Bernstein, who is already involved. So for what it's worth, I wanted to mention that there's already lots of academic research going into, what if factoring huge numbers suddenly becomes not hard anymore? And, you know, you'll need a bunch more atoms. And it's not, and again, we know that these sorts of things never get worse. They only get better. And so they'll get six atoms, then they'll get seven, then they'll get eight, then they'll get nine. Now, they're going to need a whole lot more atoms in order to factor numbers with as many bits as current large RSA keys have. And then apparently you start having other problems which five atoms don't have, like keeping like 2,000 of them all like disciplined in your ion trap. Anyway, so I just wanted to assure people that, you know, we're at the point today where breakthroughs are factoring the number 15. And it's what's cool is that somehow five atoms do that. And that, you know, someday I think it's we can see the path. And that is that factoring a really huge number into the two primes that were multiplied to originally get it, which is that's the hard thing about the hardness in RSA crypto, is that it's trivial to multiply two primes to get a big number. We don't know how to, in any reasonable amount of time, break that apart again, to take that big number and figure out the two primes that were used to create it. And somehow, apparently, someday, some atoms will do that instantly. I hope I am alive to see that happen, because that would just then it's time to figure out, okay, how are atoms doing this? I have no idea how five atoms can factor a number, but
it's pretty cool.
That's what it is. Just the idea of that happening is very cool.
But that's the point. It's kind of a distant, I hope I'm alive when they can do it kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And I should also mention that the NSA is already getting ready to propose the standard for the net. Oh, and in fact, that's mentioned in this 47-minute YouTube piece that I hope everybody will listen to or watch. And it's heads. It's talking heads, although they're cool looking heads. So I would, you know, watch it if you can. Otherwise,
famous
just
heads.
They're, and there's one guy on the end who's like, what if, are these hair extensions here? I don't know what's going on. But, you know, they're, oh my God. Next week's t-shirt is the best thing I've ever seen. It shows an employed programmer standing next to an unemployed programmer.
Yeah.
And then someone sent me another picture of two headshots, and that is these guys. These guys' employment with the university, I mean, their tenure is so deep that they can look like anything they want to. And really, they're kind of supposed to.
Right.
You know,
yeah,
Rivest
you wouldn't trust
looks,
them. Yeah.
Rivest looks normal. And it's like, well, what do you know?
Yeah, how could you be a wizard?
You know? You don't look like a wizard. Exactly.
That's funny.
Or like you have hair extensions.
Yeah.
So anyway, they mention in there toward the end that the NSA is already proposing the post-quantum algorithm. So they exist, you know, this book is, you know, that's what it's got, is discussing post-quantum crypto. And one of these days, I'm just going to, you know, figure it out. If I ever go, if I ever take a vacation, or maybe when I'm on the plane, you know, vibrating my way up to Petaluma, I'll use the time to get in and be able to describe how five atoms are able to factor something, because I'm getting to the point where I need to know, and I know our users want me to explain it. So our users, our listeners, our followers. Okay, so Verizon is fined $1.35 million. And I look at that, and I don't think I was sipping coffee, or I might have like had to wipe off the screen, because that's nothing for Verizon. That's like they don't even feel it. It's a slap on the wrist. This was a fine that the FCC imposed for their use of super cookies that we've talked about, which is a completely pernicious, privacy-violating technology that they implemented in a way that they were unblockable, thus the superness, unless you used HTTPS. And this was that as a Verizon wireless customer, you are using their gateway, essentially. You know, they're your wireless ISP. So by definition, all of your traffic goes through their portal, and any that wasn't encrypted, any browser queries or HTTP queries had a Verizon super cookie added, which was tied to your account, and which we now know they were sharing with others. That is, they were remarketing their tracking of their customers to other parties. So what annoyed me about the 1.3 million is they made vastly more than that much money doing this. So from their, you know, boardroom standpoint, this was a highly profitable venture. You know, 1.35 million is the toll for doing this. Fine, we'll pay it. Can we keep doing it? We'd be happy to pay this every year. They've agreed in their consent agreement to obtain consumer consent before sending data about super cookies under the settlement. And I'm still, you know, it's like, okay, let's wait to see how this comes out. Because the idea is there's language in there that says users can opt out. Well, does that mean you can change your mind after agreeing? And how do you do that? And, you know, what we really want, and unfortunately, it's probably not there, I'm sure it's not there, is a timeout where you have to opt in and it expires after 6 months. And then you have to opt in again. I mean, that's the fair way to do it. And who knows? And we've discussed this before. Would Verizon maybe give you a discount on your costs if you opt in? Then a lot of people are going to say, yeah, I'd rather have cheaper service. And I don't care about that tracking business. And remember, it's still, until they start forcing a certificate on their users, which is frighteningly, you know, likely, they could only do this for non-encrypted traffic. But anyway, this made the news. A lot of our listeners sent it to me, so I wanted to just comment. It's like, yeah, okay, big deal. You know, again, if this was the cost of doing it, they'd happily do it. They'd happily pay the fine annually, because it was no doubt making, you know, they were generating so much revenue from this. We have yet to see how they're going to implement this. It seems unlikely that there'll be a timeout. And I just hope they make it clear what's going on so people can choose. Again, if they give somebody a $5 discount a month on their service, then certainly a lot of people are going to say yes. And a lot of people are going to say, no thanks.
The bigger punishment would be people read this article and go, oh, well, I guess I don't want Verizon to be my cell phone company and switch.
Exactly.
But you know what? Nobody cares. Mm-mm. That's my sad realization.
Facebook had a little bit of an oops. Really, and this was an interesting hack. And in the details, I found myself realizing that Facebook still hadn't gotten it right, which is makes it a perfect subject for the podcast too. So, what happened was that a researcher poking around discovered that he was able to hack anyone's Facebook account for whom he had their phone number or email address. And so the way it works is as follows. There is a page you go to when you forget your password. And it's like find your account or something is the title. I went there this morning and looked at it. And it's like, you know, enter your email address or a phone number, you know, which are registered to your account. And it sends you this the now becoming commonplace six-digit code. I don't know why six, because, you know, Apple's decided to put six-digit on its lock screen. All the one-time tokens are all six digits. It's basically, that's enough that somebody can't guess it. And the technology verifying is able to say, you got it wrong, sorry. Okay, so what he found was that what happens is you enter that, then it sends the code to your phone through a text message or to email and changes the page waiting for you to enter that six-digit code. So he puts the wrong one in and it says wrong, try again. He puts the wrong one in and it says wrong, try again. Puts the wrong one in, it says wrong, try again. Now at this point I'm thinking, okay,
gotta take a while.
Part of this process do Facebook's users, I mean, do Facebook's engineers not understand? Because this is not supposed to be try a lot.
Until you find one.
Until you find one.
It's not. This is now, not something you forgot. This is something they just gave you.
Precisely. So I could say, oops, maybe you made a typo. We'll give you one more try. Then you're going to have to ask for another one. That's the way these work.
Yeah.
But Facebook said,
keep trying.
And for some bizarre reason, their main Facebook site lets you go between, and he said 10 to 12. Maybe he wasn't counting because he got bored guessing. But 10 to 12 before it says, sorry, you apparently have a real problem with six-digit code.
But there's still a million codes, right? I mean, it's not like...
Correct. And they are blocking you after somewhere between 10 to 12.
Well, that seems all right. I mean, it's...
No, Leo, it's wrong. It is a fundamental flaw in their cryptography. You may think I'm being Gibsonian about this.
Well, tell me why. Because to brute force it, you'd need many, many guesses, right?
Yes. But...
Many more than 10.
This is not the way the code works. The code is sent to you. You enter it. And I could acknowledge being given one if you typed it in carelessly. They would say, sorry.
Right.
Try it again. And if you mistake, then they say, okay, you seem to have a problem with this particular code. Go back, re-enter your information, we'll send you another one. My point is the security model is clean and it's clear. It's there is no reason you should possibly need 10. You might have a redo, so you get one another try. And then you just ask for another code that kills that one. And they present. So what I'm saying is this demonstrates that would demonstrate a proper understanding of the way this is supposed to work. What Facebook has done, 10? I mean, how can, there's no, it's inexplicable. But okay, even so, Facebook.com was blocking after 10 to 12. However, beta.facebook.com and mbasic.beta.facebook.com are two other full copies of Facebook that are, you know, the developmental, not yet prime time, that had the whole content and no protection. They just...
You can enter any code, you mean?
Any code forever, Leo. And it's an since it's an automated submission, when you the and he in the disclosure, this guy showed that it was a, you know, it is an HTTP query of that is LSD. I thought that was interesting. I don't know what that stands for. Equals AVOYWO13, then ampersand N equals, and then the six digits. And you can issue those as fast as you want.
Huh.
And there's no limit if you issue them to the beta. To the beta.facebook.com. And what that does is, since there's no limit, he at machine speed runs through, and there are a million six-digit codes. So, you know, 0000000.
So he still has to get the right one.
999999. Correct. No limit, and with a but a million. I mean, so it's going to take a while, but the system is just sitting there.
No, try again. No, try again. No, that's not it. Try that.
Right.
Try again.
And it's automatable.
It doesn't say warmer, colder, does it?
And since he didn't want to. Okay, you got
getting
four
warm.
Of those, right.
And do it like really Mastermind. Two
surprised.
Are right, and one is in the right position.
this clown who set it to 10 attempts, I'm surprised he didn't say, "Okay, you missed one of those digits."
Yeah.
Can no, and we're but we're going to give you some more tries. Oh, Jesus. Anyway, so he responsibly cracked his own account, so that he wasn't cracking anybody else's.
So he went through it. Now, the average would be 500,000 tries, right? I don't know
correct.
How that works. Is that right? It's just it's one half of the total.
Yeah, correct.
Okay.
Yes. So
you're getting no clues. So
right.
That's a lot of tries.
He cracked his own account. He told Facebook. They said, "Oops," and they turned on the limiter, the 10 to 12 invalid attempt limiter from main Facebook. They added it to the beta.facebook.com. And then he disclosed. So nobody, as far as we know, nobody was hacked. But it had, again, if anybody else had found this and knew any user's email address or phone number, now that user would have received a notice of a password reset attempt. So they would have received the proper six-digit code either on their phone or by email. We get those. Everybody sometimes gets it, like, okay, somebody tried to log in.
Yeah, I get them all the time. Yeah,
people yeah, exactly. So it's like, okay, fine. You know, so you just sort of blow it off. But that would have started the hacker's attempt then to brute force that six-digit code to successfully get your account, at which point he can change your password, has access to your credit card numbers in your in your payments section of Facebook, and basically full authentication of your identity, able to do everything you could do, freshly authenticated and re-authenticatable on demand user, owner of that account. So anyway, a little bit of an oops, but also it's like, okay, if they can't get it in two tries, don't keep giving them more chances. Why, why 10? Just tell them to get another one. That's the way the algorithm should work. Spoofing. I didn't ask you how many sponsors we have today.
Just one more.
Okay. Because I was going to say this would have been a good time to break, but we'll continue.
We got time.
I'll
break after spin, right? Yeah.
Perfect.
All right.
So spoofing a fingerprint got easier. Some researchers at Michigan State University's there in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering used a very cool hack You might want to go to this link, Leo. Okay. It's agic.cc/en. agic.cc/en. This is the Japanese company which sells, and if you click on the hobbyist side up at the top, those two blocks, they sell the ability to print a circuit board.
Oh, that's neat.
Isn't that cool?
That's neat.
So they have and this is something that people are doing. So they have a special paper which receives a high silver content ink. So there are a number of inkjet printers which are compatible, and they list those further down that page. You replace its three cartridges with their three cartridges and use their paper, and you can then print working circuits.
Wow, that is really cool.
Yeah.
I love that.
It is really neat.
I got to tell Father Robert, we'll do a know-how with that one. That's awesome.
Totally makes sense, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, poke some holes through and then run some components through and you're good to go.
Wow.
Unfortunately, it's conductive, which means it's going to have a variable capacitance just like a fingerprint's ridges do.
Oh, dear.
So now this is the new way of spoofing fingerprint
readers. You can inkjet print them.
Yes. Yes.
What?
So you take a picture of somebody's fingerprint, maybe from their own phone, or maybe from, you know, the wine glass that you handed them. Because you wanted them to get a clean thumbprint from them.
Right.
So then you horizontally invert it, clean it up, and then print it at 1-to-1 size using this inkjet printer with their paper and their ink. This makes a conductive raised ridges copy of the fingerprint, and it does work. They may not have had an iPhone, but they did talk. They said they opened a Samsung Galaxy S6 and a Huawei Honor 7 that were both biometrically locked. And it's just easy. The previous hack or spoof that we described back when the fingerprint reader was new came from Germany's Chaos Computer Club. And we'll remember that they did this using a gummy finger, which they had 2.5D printed. They had a 2.5D printer and some sort of a gummy stuff. So they created, because they understood they needed 3D-ness. And they may have sprayed it with something to make it conductive afterwards. I don't remember. But now we have an advance of the technology where, you just print a fingerprint. Or you could keep a spare fingerprint in your wallet if you needed to,
Handy. If you lose your hand, you can always...
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, or you need to give it to a relative or something.
Here's my fingerprint. You know? Yeah. You can use this.
Fingerprint.
Yeah. Get it in my phone. Wow.
Yeah. Very cool. Very cool. Okay. McAfee. Oh, boy. You know, I was put in mind of Donald Trump because he acknowledged that he lied specifically to generate YouTube traffic and then boasted 700,000 views of him saying, basically, they should just give the phone to me. I can unlock it in no time. It's just not going to be a problem. And it's like, okay, John. I mean, I didn't cover this for the last couple of weeks because I was just rolling my eyes. But this is just a wonderful interview that the Daily Dot did. So McAfee says, or originally he said, I speak through the press to the press and to the general public. For example, last night I was on RT and I gave a vastly oversimplified, a vastly oversimplified explanation of how you would hack into the iPhone, I can't possibly go in and talk about the insecure or talk about the secure spaces on the A7 chip. I mean, who's going to understand that crap? Nobody. But you got to believe me. I understand it.
Oh, yeah, sure.
And I do know what I'm doing. Yeah, else, I would not be where I am. And I think,
Where are you?
With dogs being shot by neighbors in Bolivia?
Where are you? Yes. You
know? Yeah, exactly.
I made me the man I am today.
Where did we leave off with your escape from South America? Oh. Anyway, so he says, but you got to believe me. I understand it. And I do know what I'm doing. Else, I would not be where I am. This is a fact. Someone who does not understand software cannot start a multi-billion-dollar company. I'm just gagging. And he says, this is just a fact of life. So, if I look like an idiot, it's because I am speaking to idiots.
Oh, that'll go over well.
Oh, yeah. But I promise you this. You get me on a coding table, and I think...
Coding table? They make those now?
What is a coding table? You get me on a coding table.
What a coding table.
Against somebody, I will kick your ass, says John. Oh, okay, so the interviewer says, anything else you'd like to talk about? And of course, McAfee, never one who's shy or short for words, says, yeah. If you're on Reddit, tell those guys, cut me a little slack.
Oh.
I am not quite as stupid as they think I think. I mean, I may be pretty damn stupid, but nowhere near what they think. And if somebody wants to test me, please bring a laptop, a coding pencil.
Oh, to go with this coding table.
What is that? One with a big eraser? What is a coding pencil?
I'm now thinking he's never written any code.
I know he hasn't. Bring a laptop, a coding pencil, or ask them how to. Here's one. If you have a computer with no memory and only two registers, how do you exchange register A, and he actually means the contents of register A, with the contents of register B? And all you have are Boolean operators. Now, you ask them that. How many people can do that within 1 minute?
1 minute?
That's the question.
A timer?
The coding pencil is going to expire after
yes,
a minute.
Yes, after apparently. A minute, you have your time is up.
That's the question I used to ask everybody who came to work for me at McAfee. Mm-hmm. Right, because his multi-billion-dollar company, he was still doing the hiring. If you can't solve that in a minute, you're an idiot. You shouldn't be programming. And I guarantee you that 99% cannot do it.
Oh, come on.
He says, two registers, only Boolean operators, no memory, and you must exchange the contents of those two registers. So you don't have adds and subtracts. No, only Boolean and or XOR. You got it?
Oh, you have XOR. And, good, all right.
And so the interviewer says, I will pass that challenge along. McAfee says, again, and
see,
just tell
you're
them.
You're an idiot.
The first time somebody asked me that question, I popped out the answer instantly.
Oh, because he's a genius with his coding pencil and his coding
table. Oh, my Lord. Yeah.
Well, we now know who Mr. Trump will be nominating for vice president, I think.
And you understand now why I was put in mind of the Donald. Is this like, okay, this, you know.
I'm a genius. They're all idiots.
In a different venue. Anyway, so, you know, of course, we've discussed this years ago. It even has its own Wikipedia page. this clever but inefficient technique. I mean, it's rare that you don't have a swap instruction, or Intel calls it the exchange, XCHG. But three XOR operations between those two registers can swap their contents.
Wait a minute, Steve. You didn't use your whole minute.
I know. Sorry.
But you probably had a faster coding pencil.
And I would argue that any programmer learns this in 101. In like Boolean math, it's like it's a cool thing that you can do this. Anyway, so I just, this was typical John. This is why I didn't bother us for the last couple of weeks with him, you know, with his shoe challenge, because it was just nonsense. But I just loved
his shoe now. Like, I really do.
Yeah.
That's great.
Okay, so RSA. I just had a short note to make sure people knew that there was a 47-minute panel conversation. The YouTube link, the bit.ly, bit.ly/RSA crypto, RSACRIPTO. It's riveting. Absolutely. As I said, first of all, you got to see these guys. They're classic, crypto people, except Rivest, who like really needs to be weird somehow. Maybe if we could just give him, you know, maybe rose colored glasses or something. But anyway, definitely fun.
I'm pulling a tiny it up bit right of now. I'll just let people who are watching the video. Just you talk, because I mean, obviously most people are listening. They're not going to see the video. They can have to do this for themselves. But I'm just curious what these guys look like now. Now you got me. You got me going. Oh yeah, they look like the guy on the right.
That's my guy. That's my guy with the hair.
Okay.
Wait till we get a close-up of him. He's a character.
Now, who is the elder gentleman who looks like Gandalf?
That's Whitfield Diffie.
Whit Diffie, by the way, won the Turing Prize, $1 million Turing Prize. Yep. He deserves it. And who is this guy?
That's Mr. Hair.
I love it. And he's wearing a pink shirt. It's really interesting. And it looks like a puka shell.
Classic group. And we have that in the middle there is a Shamir of RSA.
Now, Shamir, by the way, just recently said at RSA, no doubt, that Apple should give the FBI anything it wants, which surprised me, since he invented the public key crypto.
He did. And in fact, Whit Diffie was at the AI lab at Stanford when I was there.
Oh, really?
He had a number of neat.
I've interviewed Whit.
He was big on Space War. We used to play Space War.
Oh, what fun, huh?
At four in the morning. Yeah.
Put that on your MAME. I'm sure this was fascinating. We shouldn't mock people's appearance because, of course, they're geniuses.
No, they're wonderful. Yeah. I mean, it's like as I said, they're wonderful.
Yeah.
Okay, so Toby tweets me, and actually,
that was Moxie Marlin Spike.
Is that Moxie?
That's Moxie Marlin Spike.
Okay.
Of course it is. I should have recognized him.
Yep. Yep.
With a name like Moxie Marlin Spike, it's got to be good.
Once again, yes.
No hair shaming, Moxie. We love you. Keep up the good work.
Nice. Okay, so Toby tweeted both of us. He said, updated Windows 10 and hating it. What operating system would you recommend? FreeBSD or Linux Mint?
Yeah, I ignored that because it's a complicated answer. Not doable in 140 characters, frankly.
Precisely not. But for me, anybody can DM me and vice versa came to my rescue.
Good.
And Toby was following me. So I just thought it was an opportunity. I'm going to try to figure out what it is about upgrading. And I think the best analogy I have, what I think it is it's, it's not really learned helplessness. It's a domain where we have no expertise. That is where we cannot form we don't have an informed opinion. And the best now, I came up with an extreme example to highlight it. And that is somebody hands you an axe and says, okay, chop down this tree. And so, you know, you grab it and swing back. And the person says, whoa, 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 no, 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 no. You're holding it wrong. You're supposed to hold the blade and whack the trunk of the tree with the handle. And you'd say, what? And they'd say, yeah, that's how I want you to chop the tree down. And you'd say, well, you're a moron. That's not how an axe is used. and they'd say, yeah, but I'm telling you, I'm an expert in
tree chopping. That's where you got to watch out.
This is how you, and the key is you know better. And so, I run into this now within the medical area all the time.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I'm studying research, reading studies, proactively educating myself on tightly focused, specific topics. And I end up becoming a small topic expert. And, you know, those are the things I've shared with people, like the Vitamin D podcast and the Sugar Hill stuff. Digging into the science, understanding it, putting it all together so that it makes sense. Mm-hmm. And so, the problem that most people have is that, you know, it's not an axe. It's way more complicated than that.
Right.
And so they don't know. And so here we come to Windows 10. Same thing.
It's not an axe.
It's not an axe. You know, we know what I think it is.
Something.
I can quote it.
Yes.
So Toby says he hates Windows 10. What should he do? So I tweeted back, Toby, for the time being, I'm staying with Win 7. I think it's perfect. It predates Microsoft's switch to OS as an over-communicating social media service. It will be kept updated until 2020. It runs a recent model IE for talking to Microsoft. It supports all of the latest communication security standards, forward secrecy, TLS version 1.2, SHA 256, etc. It's available in mature 32 and 64-bit versions. So plenty of RAM expansion space. It's supported by current laptop and desktop hardware. It runs the user with reduced writes, which can be easily and transiently elevated when needed. And of course, it also manages all peripheral I/O devices, storage, and networking, launches all 32 and 64-bit Windows apps, includes a free built-in VM for running XP, and much older 16-bit apps if needed. It can be easily tweaked to never upgrade to Windows 10. What's not to love? And what more could anyone want or need?
Right.
And so that's my point is, you know, there's this sense of need to upgrade because there is something newer. And I remember the love fest that Paul and Mary Jo had over Windows 8 and then 8.1. Now, it also is a flying we-know-what and a horrible mistake that Microsoft should have never made, and they love Windows 10. To me, it's like, okay, I'm staying with 7, which absolutely does what I need.
There you go.
So,
and we'll cross the bridge of what the hell to do when it,
In 4 years. Yeah, and I'm happy to have 4 years. And you know me, I mean, I'm still using XP. So, and there'll probably be an embedded version that still gets updates, you know, until you're on your boat.
I should have answered his question. I wouldn't go with Linux Mint at this point. Although I have to say it's a shame because it is the most Windows-like version of Linux and very easy for people to use. But unfortunately, they've made some decisions about upgrading that I think are problematic. So, I'd go with Ubuntu, I think, is a fine version of Linux.
There's also a desktop version of FreeBSD, which I've looked at a little bit. I don't know how it compares at all. But
it's fine. It's good. And, of course, as we know, that's the most secure of all operating systems. I mean, really, but both through obscurity and through design. So that's another good choice, I think.
Yeah.
But harder to use, I think, for an end user, especially somebody coming from Windows.
Yeah, and it's a certainly function of your techno level.
Exactly.
I'm with you 1,000%, Leo, in recommending the Chromebook to people who just need to surf the web and do email.
Yeah.
I downloaded just because I was curious, another email client which can do IMAP and was able to do GRC. Email on the Chromebook, so you certainly aren't constrained to just.
Is it a plugin? It must be a Chrome plugin, right?
Cloud something.
Oh, okay,
but it runs on the Chromebook, and I have all my email. I'm not using it seriously because I really do want a strong machine, but I just wanted to verify that, like, if somebody got it and they were a Cox subscriber, that they could, set it up to still get their mail through Cox and not have to, for example, do web mail, which Cox does offer. That works.
Good.
Last week, we talked briefly about my evolving healthy sleep formula, and you mentioned your success with it. Naturally, a great number of our listeners also cannot sleep well through the night. And the statistics show that about a third of the population as we get older especially, has a recurring significant problem, enough so that they say, yes, I can't sleep. It wasn't a deluge because people were waiting but people were like, I got a lot of DMs saying, and just regular public tweets saying, I really need it. Can you just, I know it's not done, can you share it? So there is a page that I threw together, but you no longer even need a URL because it's gotten loose. And I wanted somebody other than me to Google this to see if it's the first link for non-me, because we know that Google tends to bias itself. So if you Google healthy sleep formula, Leo, what's the first thing that comes up?
No word of Gibson in that, just healthy sleep formula.
Mm-hmm.
GRC, healthy sleep formula, number one. Okay. Number one on the hit parade. So it's easy to find.
Easy to find.
And now you have to add taurine to this, though.
It's on the page. I didn't put it up in the top six, but you'll see that second box there says, and get yourself some taurine.
Now, it would behoove me at this point to say Steve is not a doctor, and you should always, before taking a supplement, consult your physician to make sure it doesn't interact with your own medications dangerously, because that's always a possibility.
Yes.
So don't just blithely go out there. However, I have taken it, and it has made a big difference. Now, I'm hoping it's not addictive, and I'm not going to get cancer in 6 months, but I trust Steve. If you don't know Steve as well as I do, you might want to consider that this is just, one guy's thing. Okay, now I've said the disclaimer. Works for me.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. And I've already had reports of it working.
It's amazing.
Yes, I've never had a report yet of it not working.
Well, when we all get cancer in a year, maybe. But, right now, it's good.
Well, none of this stuff is weird. It's all either in us or it's the main amino acid in green tea. The L-theanine is the predominant amino acid in green tea.
And you're recommending around 200 milligrams. Is that kind of comparable to a few cups of tea or a million cups of tea or...
You have to drink.
It's not an unreasonable amount, I would guess.
No, it's not. This is a standard offered supplement level.
Yeah, you're getting these from Now for three of them, which is a well.
And they're a great company. Yeah. So GABA is the existing neurotransmitter that we already have in us. Glycine, same thing, is a neurotransmitter and the smallest amino acid. So it's in our diet and it's all in us already. Melatonin is the hormone which our pineal gland secretes at night when there's a lack of blue light.
By the way, you're number two in Germany, according to Martin.
You're cool. and the first ingredient, seraphose, is a version of phosphatidylserine, which is...
Oh, you had me taking that before.
Yes, exactly. That is the... What it does is it sensitizes and actually recovers the sensitivity of the cortisol sensors that the hypothalamus and the pituitary both use to determine whether their request for cortisol to be released has been met by our adrenal glands. And so there's a negative feedback loop such that when cortisol is released, the hypothalamus stops releasing, adrenal corticotropic hormone, and that goes to the adrenal gland, which releases corticotropic releasing hormone, which then goes to the adrenal glands and causes them to release cortisol. When they sense that cortisol is available, then they downregulate their request for more. So it's a negative feedback loop. The problem is, as we age, that cortisol sensing becomes less sensitive. So the hypothalamus and the pituitary sense less cortisol, therefore asking for more than we really need. So what phosphatidylserine does is, among other things, it brings the sensitivity of those receptors back up. It improves their sensitivity, thus cortisol is reduced. That's why I had you taking it, because cortisol is a problem for a big chunk of the population because of chronic stress. It's in this healthy sleep formula because it's also a problem at night for people not being able to get to sleep or waking up too early. So all of these have a specific reason. And in fact, it turns out that phosphatidylserine and GABA are synergistic, and it helps GABA to cross the blood-brain barrier, which is one of the reasons people don't think that supplementing with GABA actually works. Anyway, I do at the bottom of that page explain the first of those five. I haven't had time to get to taurine yet, but it's going to get added.
How much? Because I didn't pay for any of this. I just got it in the box. It came to me.
Yeah, and in fact, that's a very good point. I show the prices of Amazon's, but I also note someone told me that in the UK, I think it was, or no, it was in Canada, he said that the Seraphose was like $50-some.
Whoa.
And I said, whoa. So I checked ca.iherb.com, and it's the normal price there. And so...
As soon as people find out about this, it's all going to double. Because if it really does what you says it does, it's worth whatever that is. You know, $5 a night. Is it how much a night is it roughly?
I haven't done the math. Yeah. I will
get a spreadsheet out to do that.
Yeah. Well, and again, people need to understand. At the top of the page, I say this is a beta at this point. You know, I reserve the right I need to still play with it a little bit, and it's slow going. Because, like, I'll take something out, and I'll wake up at 4 a.m. It's like, gosh darn it.
Yeah, it takes a whole night to try each one.
Well, worse than that, the next night you can't count on because you had a bad night the night before.
Well. Right.
So there's sleep pressure. So it basically takes several nights, like three nights, to recover from taking one out, and then it destroys the way the thing fits together. But I've been putting it together. Every single thing is innate to us in reasonable concentrations. And in fact, again, what I end up doing when I get time is each one of those will get its own page because, for example, taurine, and I should just mention that taurine can lower your blood pressure. So if you're on high blood pressure medication, you want to make sure you don't undershoot.
This is why you want to consult your physician because there's interactions with all this stuff.
Precisely. So I will spell those things out so that people can know. Also, this particular melatonin is time release, which is crucial for this. But
because it's a lower dose than, it was only 1 milligram.
It is, yes. And see, that's the point. People make the mistake of blasting themselves with 20 milligrams of melatonin, which is vastly more than that ever occurs biologically. And so the secret is trickling it out over the course of the night. The problem is this adds B6. And some people have a B6 sensitivity. So one of the things I'm doing now is I want to experiment. There are a couple other time-release melatonins without B6. In fact, Life Extension brand is a 300 microgram time release that I'm going to switch to. It wasn't working for me before the taurine, but with the taurine, this has really strengthened the whole thing. So I want to see if I can adjust the melatonin down and still have it work, and thus get rid of the B6. B6 is a important factor in neurotransmitter synthesis. You have to have it for some of the enzyme actions. For example, the one that it's called decarboxylase that converts the 5-HTP to serotonin. We want that to happen, and so the reason they put B6 in is it generally helps generating the calming neurotransmitters. But anyway, I have all the science behind this. I've got tons of research. I just haven't had a chance to make it public. But I did want. But you're playing with it. A bunch of people are playing with it. I've already had positive results. So someone was sensitive to the melatonin, dropped it, and didn't need it. So it may also be the case that you can go without melatonin. I'll get all this documented, but I just want to let people know it is there if you want to get it and start experimenting, understanding that it's an experiment.
Both Lisa and I were a little groggy the next morning and have been a little bit, but not badly so. Nothing.
When you took two of each, right?
Yeah, well, even last night I took one, but as you point out, it takes a couple of tries to really know what the effect is. But, nothing that a cup of coffee and a good bike ride didn't fix, but it just,
And the other thing, too, is one of the things that I experienced at the beginning of this was sort of that same sense of feeling, and I began to wonder whether it's that I was
just getting a good night's sleep.
Yes, yeah. That I was really
kind of
relaxed.
Euphoric.
Exactly. Yeah. I felt a little. In fact, I said to the gal that serves me for lunch, I said, I think I'm kind of high right now, because I was also doing taurine and glycine in the morning, and those after a good night's sleep, it'll give you kind of a nice little buzz.
Well, there are lots of reasons to think that a good night's sleep is healthful.
That's the other thing. The other thing we haven't talked about, but oh my Lord, it is unbelievably important. I mean, it's one of the things that's happened since the 50s is since the 1950s, the amount of self-reported sleep has dropped by between 1.5 and 2 hours per night.
Yeah,
people are staying up later, and they're getting up earlier. And I've heard people like on television bragging about how little they need.
I only need 2 hours sleep. Yeah,
it's like this is not a bragging
point.
That's
not a good thing.
It's really our bodies.
John McAfee sleeps 20 minutes a day.
And boy, does it show!
Look how smart he is.
Yeah, boy.
Well, again, it always makes me a little uncomfortable to recommend anything, all the standard disclaimers apply. But I think if you find something, I think this is great. I mean, I'm at this point, I actually don't not take it, because the times I haven't slept well. It's like
and I look forward. I look forward.
Yeah.
To going to sleep.
Now
there'll be one more addition or an optional, and that is if you like dreaming, there's an herb called Rhodiola rosea, and it's not in there because
it makes you dream.
It's like Oh, my Lord. And in fact, this kind of vivid dreaming, you never get into as deep a sleep as I think people should. But I know there are people who, like, occasionally would just want to, it's like 8 hours of entertainment. It's like the craziest, it's just the craziest stuff that has ever happened. It's just wonderful. So
I'll try that.
Anyway, we'll have some fun.
You know, that's the first sleep suggestion you made for me way back when I was worried about jet lag on a long trip, did cause me to dream in a lot.
Yes. In fact, what I did, you had to go to sleep super early.
Right.
For New Year's.
Oh, that was New Year's Eve. That's right.
Before last.
Yeah.
So we had to knock you out so you'd be able to go to sleep at
right. And it worked.
6 or something. Yeah. And it was 5-HTP and melatonin. And those two things, and you were able to get them from the local drugstore.
Yeah,
and
still have them.
Yes, and 5-HTP is a potent serotonin generator. It's the immediate precursor to serotonin. Tryptophan has a hard time crossing the blood-brain barrier, but 5-HTP doesn't. It's able to get through passive diffusion. And so if you've got enough B6, it just gets converted to serotonin, and oh, boy, will you dream.
But you don't dream much with this current formulation.
No.
Not till you're kind of starting to wake up.
For example, yes, exactly. And for example, you don't see L-tryptophan there that you would expect to see, or 5-HTP, specifically because I don't want to encourage too much serotonin. It's just it's a little distracting. I mean, in fact, I'm wearing my little Zio headband, and it's saying I'm asleep. And I'm thinking, I don't feel asleep. I feel like
I'm having fun.
And I'm not a big dreamer, and I'm not one who remembers his dreams, but I've got some, like, storylines that would freak Jenny out if I ever told them to her.
I had some very good dreams, too. So I definitely want to try that once in a while. All right. Okay. So what is that for the dreaming?
Rhodiola. Rosea. Also from Now Foods, Rhodiola. Rhodiola rosea, Rosea, and what it acts, the way the, its mechanism of action, and one of the things we're going to do when we have some time to do a special is I'm going to just do a podcast on the neurobiology of our brain, because I've had to learn it in order to understand how all of this stuff works, and It is so fascinating, and I know we would produce a podcast that even people who didn't care would just find really interesting.
Yeah.
But one of the ways that the neural signaling system works, neurotransmitters work, is after emitting this chemical, the neurotransmitter chemical, it's necessary to end the stimulation. It's meant to be an event, not a haze. And so the stimulating neuron has an active transport, it's called, which try is like little vacuum cleaners, which try to suck those back in so that it recycles them, because it's metabolically more efficient to recycle than to have to all reuptake exactly rather than rebuilding all new neurotransmitter. But because it's goo, I mean, it's sort of an aqueous environment, some of them may wander off. And you don't want sort of a cloud gathering over time, because that would be bad. So we all our biochemistry also has enzymes which go, you know, actively break down the neurotransmitters that have gotten away, that have sort of become lost. And those are called monoamine oxidase enzymes, because they oxidize the monoamine, which is what the neurotransmitter is. Thus, a monoamine oxidase inhibitor, an MAOI, that was the original form of antidepressant medication.
Right.
And so it worked by inhibiting the destruction of those neurotransmitters that had sort of wandered off, and allowed them to sort of increase their effect over time. Rhodiola rosea is a mild MAOI. And so it tends to inhibit, I think it's MAOI A and B, which are the monoamine oxidase inhibitors for both both serotonin, and I think it's glycine, and I think acetylcholine also. So anyway, this will all be, get written down, and we'll have a fun podcast sometime talking about it.
All right.
In the meantime, Jeff in Ontario, Canada, wrote with a subject, not a security question, and I happened to find this in the mailbag, thought I would share it just because there is a little bit of a takeaway from this for our listeners. He said, "Hi, Steve. I have a WD My Passport 1 terabyte portable USB hard drive. I had bought a copy of SpinRite some time ago to support you and your podcast, which I thoroughly enjoy every week. I partitioned the aforementioned portable hard disk drive with 3 primary partitions and a bunch of logical partitions. I made the drive bootable and installed a bootloader. The drive held a number of useful PC diagnostic, maintenance, and repair tools, including SpinRite, some live Linux distros, memtest, etc. A few weeks ago, I clumsily dropped my portable hard disk drive. It fell from about waist height. A few days later, I noticed I was unable to save some files to the drive from a Linux machine. The OS was showing me I/O errors. I was also unable to copy some large, over 2 gig files from the drive to my Windows 7 laptop. The Windows copy dialog was getting stuck and claiming an ETA of a couple of decades. I plugged
That's good.
Yeah. I plugged the hard drive into a spare workstation at work and booted SpinRite from the drive's first partition. I then sent SpinRite to work on all the partitions of the same drive. I'm not sure if it's a good idea to have SpinRite test the same media it booted from. It is plugged in by USB, not SATA. Do you think SpinRite can breathe new life into a hard drive that has suffered physical trauma, i.e. has been dropped? It did not hold any data that wasn't backed up, so I'm not concerned with data recovery, but I'd love to have the drive working again. Maybe I'll just get one of those shockproof portable hard disk drives, those with the rubber bumpers."
I use SSDs, which I think are more...
That's very good point. Robust. They're shockproof, yeah. And as we have found, they are subject to SpinRite's machinations in recovering when they need recovery. So that would make a lot of sense. For what it's worth, the good news is it sounds like the drive wasn't running at the time. So that's better, although it does sound like the physical drop hurt it. SpinRite has a long history from, you know, the laptop fell off the back of the couch to my dog ran by and knocked the computer over, and such stories of machines where the drives were running, the heads were flying, and they got bounced on the media. SpinRite came along and recovered the data and fixed them, and things were good to go again. So first, it absolutely can help with physically damaged drives, because that's really what sector errors are. That's physical defects that are causing the magnetic flux reversals not to be recoverable on the drive. And secondly, it's absolutely fine to run it on itself. Since it boots, it comes in, it runs, it no longer has any connection or open files or ties back to that drive. So absolutely. In fact, back when it was running from a floppy, boy, I put in a bunch of logic so that it could write a log, its log file of what it did back to the media that it was operating on, even if at the same time it needed to be relocating the sectors and the clusters that the log file was being written to. I made it all work somehow. So absolutely, it is safe to write it back to run it from the media it was booted from. And once we get back from the break, I'm going to talk about okay, you got to be kidding me. There's still some way to eke out a private key from a system whose code plays by all the rules. Yes, one more bleed. We had a heart bleed. Now we have cash bleed.
No relation to Cash Flyer. Fine content distribution network. Our show today brought to you by the Ring Video Doorbell.
Every time you're demoing it, I'm thinking, wow, that thing is still going.
It was a year on the battery.
The little thing spins around. And, yeah.
So you don't normally use the battery on the Ring Video Doorbell. I mean, if you have a wired doorbell in your house, you just connect it to that. That's how I did it at home. And they give you everything to install. And why would you want to install the Ring Video Doorbell? Well, one very simple reason. This is like caller ID for your house. It's a doorbell that replaces your regular doorbell, but has a few nice extra features. Still rings a dinger in your house if you have a wired doorbell. But now this has an HD wide-angle camera, speaker, and microphone in it. Ties to your Wi-Fi. And now when anybody rings the door at your house, it doesn't just ring in the house, it rings everywhere. It rings the Ring app on your smartphone or your tablet. You can answer the door from your smartphone or tablet. It doesn't unlock the door, but you can speak to the person. Say, leave the package, or I'm not home right now. Actually, you probably don't want to say I'm not home right now, because the whole point of this is you sound like you are home. So if a bad guy comes to your door, you know, often they'll ring the doorbell first, see if you're home. You say, yeah, what is it? And they go, Would you like a free window washing treatment? No, thank you. Bye. They run away. So this is a very effective security measure. Great for your, by the way, if you have elderly parents or people who or you live alone or know people who live alone who would like this kind of security, it is a great feeling. See, it comes with the drill bit, it comes with the level, it comes with the screwdriver, even the charging cable, because yes, you can install it where there is no wired doorbell. And the big old lithium ion battery in here will go for up to a year without charging. And that means you've got a doorbell all of a sudden, which is a pretty cool thing. The Ring Video Doorbell, $200, worth every penny. We've got one on our front door. In fact, I think pretty much everyone at Twit now has a Ring Video Doorbell. You know, we all got the Ring religion. You know who else did? Richard Branson. He had a visitor at his Necker Island retreat, and their Ring went off on their smartphone. They answered the door. Branson looked over and said, "What did you just do?" And the fellow explained. And Branson said, "I've got to invest in this." He's led a $28 million round of investment a few months ago. And Ring is, as a result, coming up with some great new products as well. I think you're going to love your Ring Video Doorbell. Visit ring.com/security now, and we'll arrange free expedited FedEx shipping for you. Works on your Apple or Android device or your Windows 10 computer or tablet. And it rings. And oh, by the way, they have a variety of finishes, so it matches your house. And it rings wherever you are. You'll never miss a ding. With your Ring Video Doorbell. Ring.com/security now. We love it. And we know you will too. All right. Let's talk CacheBleed with Steve Gibson.
Yeah, I'm seeing them like advertised on major networks.
They're everywhere now. It's a huge success story. It's really great. Yeah. And we're really happy to be part of that, I think.
Okay. CacheBleed. The well understood rules for avoiding or preventing cache side channel attacks of any kind depend upon where the attacks depend upon a secret based alteration to the code path. We've talked about this before. The idea being that any encryption or decryption is, by its nature, is using an algorithm which is typically a standard, and it is a keyed algorithm where the key provides the secret that specifies the details of how the algorithm scrambles the bits or unscrambles the bits going in and coming out. And the idea is that by looking at the bits on both sides, you gain no useful information about the key, and that the key itself has enough bits that it's impractical to try all the combinations of bits. So you've got a strong system. What we don't want is the use of the dynamic use of this algorithm to leak any information about the key's bits. That would be bad. And so the example we've discussed where this is done in this is done wrongly is if you ever have a branch which branches the code based on bits of the key, then the act of branching changes the timing and the power consumption enough that somebody on the outside can detect it. And whereas once upon a time, people would have said, yeah, so what? I mean, you can't use that. No one's, but boy, you give these academicians a challenge and they will wrestle it to the floor. And so now all kinds of attacks have been demonstrated. And we discussed one last week or the week before, like through a wall that magnetic emanations of something decrypting a PGP was able to obtain the private key from just listening to the magnetic output from a standard laptop sitting on the other side of the wall. So it's like, yes, this stuff has been, you know, reduced to nearly practical level. So the OpenSSL guys are aware of this, and they have used only fixed time instructions where the instructions arguments depend upon secret key data so that there's no variation and no conditional branching is done that depends upon secret data. But there's a third rule, which has people have been aware of it, but it hasn't ever, it's one of those things where, again, there just didn't seem to be a practical way of taking advantage of it. The third rule is do not use memory access patterns that depend upon secret key data. Now, this is interesting and becomes a little tougher, maybe, not to have the memory access patterns, not even memory access, depend upon secret key data. So it turns out that crypto algorithms, which exist today, which are side channel attack proof, explicitly made so. Even though in some cases they're slowed down because they can't use if they could use the secret key, they could make it like I can have that direct branches. They could make it so much faster, but nope, can't do that. So they've had to slow the algorithms down, de-optimize them in terms of speed in order to optimize a different characteristic, which is absolutely no variation based on the secret. That is variation in the instructions which are executed. Turns out that people have worried about variations in the data which is fetched. And thus, they have found a way to do this. And the good news is, it is much more invasive than even, you know, than any kind of a receiver nearby sniffing something. Because, again, this has been understood to be a problem, but no one has been able to see, like, how to actually leverage it. For example, the data that is being fetched is probably not something you can detect at a distance. Yes, we've seen that the instructions you execute can. Variations in those can be detected. But, you know, you've got three levels of caching that's going to blur things. The architecture of today's systems are, for example, in an Intel multi-core processor, you have some number of cores. We'll just say four for the sake of argument. And that's kind of middle of the road now. They go up to eight, I think, maybe two. So you'll have a core. The cores are hyper-threaded meaning that they have essentially two program counters, being which means that that core, that processor can have two threads of execution actually running through it at the same time. And in the old days, you just had one. You had a program counter, and it specified the address from which the next instruction would be fetched. And a jump instruction changed the value of the program counter, thus causing the next instruction from which you would be fetched to be something else, not just moving linearly forward, which is what the program counter, that's the name counter, does by default. So these new cores have two threads, because that's found to be it's inexpensive for Intel to put a second program counter in terms of chip real estate. It doesn't make the chip much bigger. And although it's not nearly as good as a second whole core, it's enough better than only one program counter for the cost that it's now what all the Intel processors do. They're all hyper-threaded because it just makes sense. So the level one cache is the cache nearest to those cores, and they're small, and there's a separate instruction cache and data cache, meaning that fetches for data are asked of the data cache, the L1 data cache, and in fetches for instructions are asked for from the small instruction cache. They're separate instruction and data caches. And so, for example, if you were executing in a tight loop, then the instructions you had just recently executed would still be in the instruction cache, and so you wouldn't have to go any further outside the core, or even to the level two cache in the core in order to get those instructions. But instruction and data is separate. So also part of the core is the next stage, the level two cache, which is significantly larger and is a shared cache. Instructions and data both share the same cache. And then outside of all the cores is the L3, the level three cache, which is still bigger again, maybe a couple megabytes on some of the newer, larger processors. So all of that is on one Intel chip, is the level three cache, which is the main buffer for all of the external RAM on the system's motherboard. And then that big level three cache feeds all of the individual core's level two caches, which then in turn feed each core's split level one instruction and data caches. Okay, so what these guys figured out was that they could target software which does violate this third law, this third rule of not allowing memory access patterns to be a function of the secret key. I don't know if we're going to be able to harden our crypto code against that, because that's a high bar. But I imagine some people will start trying. What they found, what they were able to leverage, what is known as a cache bank conflict. So to facilitate access to the cache, that is the level one cache, and to allow concurrent access to the level one cache. Remember, we've got two threads running on in a single core, and those two threads share the level one cache. So to allow concurrent access to that level one cache, the cache is divided into multiple banks. And in the processor that these researchers tested, there were 16 banks of, I think it was four, there were 4 bytes wide. So 16 banks of, although I don't know how many lines in the cache, so they may be larger, but 16 banks. And the idea being that one thread, what dividing the L1 cache into 16 banks does is, as you would imagine, it reduces the conflicts. That is, if they were one bank, then essentially the threads would have to alternate for access to the level one cache because they would always be wanting instructions and data from the level one cache. It's the closest one to them. If they break them up into 16, then the probability of a collision, that is the both of the hyper threads simultaneously asking for something in the same cache, is 1/16th of the time. Most of the time, 15/16ths of the time, assuming random fetching patterns, they will not be colliding. Okay, but if they collide with that 1/16th probability, one of the threads stalls. And that can be detected. And it turns out it can be detected by the thread that got stalled. So this is why this is not a huge run around screaming hair on fire problem. Essentially, you are running this malware or probeware, whatever you want to call it. This is not a passive attack by any means. You're not sniffing anything. You are in one of the hyperthreads, you are running something that is timing itself like crazy. And I, long time ago when I talked about harvesting entropy, I talked about the exquisite granularity of detail that the Intel processors provide to the code running in them. This is an amazing amount of sort of management housekeeping counters that just count everything. You know, branches taken, branches not taken, roads less traveled, branch predictions that were correct and mispredictions, just an amazing amount of stuff. And I suck all that in, for example, in Squirrel's client, because it's completely unpredictable and just crazy full of entropy. The one thread running in one side of a core is able to time itself and to detect when its accesses have been stalled by the other hyperthread running in the same core. And it turns out that because the data fetches, even though instruction fetches are not altered, data fetches are altered based on the key data, that thread sharing that core is actually able to, and they have done it, determine the secret key, which is when it is used by the other hyperthread in the shared core, based on minute stalls of the attacking hyperthread when it can't get to its instruction or data cache with the same speed it would expect to. And so it's like, oh, wow. Again, not a problem at a distance, not a passive attack. We have seen problems where systems of multi-cores hosting virtualized OSs, where you can breach the virtualization barrier because they are running on the same processor, even if they're in virtualized, separate, and completely independent address spaces, it is possible to actively breach that if you have a hostile agent in one, you know, like anywhere in the server that is able to sense timing changes because they are sharing processors. Here, we are running an exquisitely sensitive purpose-designed code on one hyperthread and detecting its little fluctuations and determining what the key was that was being used at the time it was being used by the other thread on the same core. So it's like, okay, we don't have to worry about this. Maybe the open SSL guys are going to worry about it. I don't know if they're going to worry about it or not. But it'll be interesting to see if mitigations are developed for this, or if people just think, okay, this, you know, at some point we got to stop worrying about, you know, how close the attacker can be before they're just, you know, in here with us in the same process, reading this stuff directly. I mean, this is almost that level of difficult to perpetrate, and I mean, it's they have to thread lock, they have to hyper thread lock their process, they have to set thread affinity and processor and hyper thread affinity in order to always be executing on the same core and the same hyper thread on the same core, and then account for, you know, other interruptions and things. I mean, they did pull it off. But they pulled it off by deliberately running on the same hyperthread. And I'm not sure whether a processor will share hyperthreads cross OS.
God, that seems like unlikely, right?
It does seem unlikely. So you might not ever be in a situation. It might be that you could have threads in the same process sharing a core, but maybe not even cross-process, let alone cross, you know, VM.
Yeah.
So probably hard to make work, but wow.
It's a neat thing to do.
Yeah. You know, techie academic example of, yes, we can still get your key. No matter, you know, even though you played by all the rules everyone does now, we broke the last one. It's like,
it seems similar to factoring 15 using four atoms.
Yeah.
It seems in that vein.
It's down there. It's
good work, you know, nice. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. And it got a really nice paper written, and we'll keep
our
eye out.
Well, I'm glad you talked about it, because I saw that and I was very curious. Well, how practical is this? Is this, you know, yep. And obviously it's highly impractical.
Yeah. This is not unlike Heartbleed, where the whole world came to a screeching halt.
Right.
And remember all the certificate revocation. In fact, it was Heartbleed and the revocation storm,
right,
which Chrome didn't honor, that caused me to do the revoked.grc.com site.
Right, right.
As it was like, hey, you know, there's all these now likely revoked or likely hacked sites that Chrome still is happy to honor. So,
well, we've all learned something here today, I'll tell you. And this was better than GABA and Seraphos combined.
I was going to say, if that didn't put you to sleep,
no.
Then we do
actually
have
I find
some
that stuff fascinating. It's awesome. Steve Gibson is at grc.com. That's where you'll go to find all of his fine works. Of course, start with SpinRite, the world's best hard drive maintenance and recovery utility, but go from there to, oh, so many things, including now the sleep formula, Gibson's healthy sleep formula. Patent pending. By the way, did you notice I have an Echo sitting right here? You see that? I'm ready to ask it any questions that come up.
Nice.
You can also, while you're there, get a copy of, Squirrel. Getting close. The forums are there.
In fact, I worked on it so much yesterday that I stole all the time I normally spend prepping for the podcast. So
wow.
I woke myself up by it with an alarm, which I don't normally
Ooh,
do.
Ow.
Because I needed to get this done. And we did put together a nice podcast.
Thank
so I'm happy for that.
And people sometimes say, Leo, if you just get out of Steve's way, we could get SpinRite 6 going or 6.1 and we could, you know. I feel bad. I feel guilty.
It's not your fault. You know, for example, someone said, Steve, I heard you and Leo talking about your sleep formula, and I know I desperately want Squirrel, I desperately need SpinRite 6.1, but I absolutely cannot sleep. So, you know, even though I need everything else you're working on, I know how busy you are. Please, 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 can't you tell me what the formula is?
That's the beauty of Steve Gibson.
And it's like, well, okay.
Everything he does is useful.
And now I'm getting back to, I'll have squirrel. I'm back to squirrel full time.
Good.
And we'll push that out and then back to 6-1.
Nice. You can also get the podcast there, of course, grc.com. And he has 16 kilobit versions, 64 kilobit versions of the audio, transcripts that are excellent and very useful if you'd like to read along while Steve talks. It's a great way to kind of enhance your understanding of it. grc.com. We have 64 kilobit audio, and we even have video at our site, twit.tv/sn. And let's see, what else? Oh, we do the show on Tuesdays, 1:30 Pacific, 4:30 Eastern time. I guess next week will probably be a Q&A, so you might want to go to grc.com/feedback if you have a
question.
Actually,
I think I'm going to push it off by one.
Okay. Well, you can still ask a question. It just
maybe.
May not get answered right away.
Yeah. My plan was to do Drown next week.
Oh, yeah.
We'll see. And I should mention also, the bottom of the Healthy Sleep Formula has a feedback link specifically for Healthy Sleep Formula. So I wanted just to point that out to people if they've got, to tell me how they're doing, what they find, what they discover.
Reports on how people are doing with it.
Oh, yeah. It is definitely a community endeavor because, at this point, it works for me. It works for you. I guess for Lisa and a bunch of people who have responded and reported. But it needs to mature over time.
Yeah, absolutely. So grc.com, and we'll be back here next Tuesday for another episode. By the way, Steve's on Twitter @sggrc. He accepts DMs from anybody, but you can also tweet at him if you want to have a public conversation @sggrc
and as you said, grc.com/feedback for next week's Q&A.
If we do one.
If we do one.
For Q&A at some point.
Hey, it'll go into the mailbag and I will see it.
Absolutely.
If not next week, then the week after.
Yeah. Hey, thanks, Steve. Always a pleasure. See you next time.
Thanks, Leo.
Security.